The session will be recorded and uploaded to the Digital Culture Network YouTube channel soon. And in case you didn't know, the Digital Culture Network supports digital skills development in arts and culture. And we have a team of 9 tech champions, each with their own specialisms, based in one of Arts Council's 9 regional offices, supporting organizations with one-to-one support, training, and resources, which you can access free of charge. So, since the formation of the Digital Culture Network over a year ago, we developed a wonderful partnership with Google Arts and Culture, who have hosted a number of digital skills training days with us. And very recently, they have partnered with us on this series of webinars called Connected to Culture, and published an excellent toolkit and a resource to go with it, which Moira from Google Arts and Culture team will demo later. Now, in terms of today's topic around digital skills, it would be an enormous understatement to say that the impact of the coronavirus has had a profound effect on arts and cultural organizations. And for many, the use of digital and new technology has provided a way to rethink their creative content and business models. So today's conversation is about understanding the digital skills that underpin that transformation. I'm hoping we will have a wide-ranging discussion on those skills, which touches on digital literacy of the British public, before hearing from the skills needs of different sectors, and finally, how an arts organisation has taken a forward-thinking view of their in-house skills needs, and some thoughts on what that might mean for all of us. So these webinars are designed very much as kind of conversation starters, rather than definite how to do something. And I hope that it will spark some thinking. So in order to cover such broad ground, we have an absolutely excellent panel whom I'll run through before we launch into the questions. We have Liz Williams. Liz, are you there?
I am, yeah. Looking forward to the discussion today, Tiina.
Great. Liz is the Chief Executive Officer of FutureDotNow, an organisation set up to help the UK stem its digital skills crisis. Liz is also the Chair of the Good Things Foundation and sits on the Board of Trustees for the London Transport Museum. On the panel, we also have Jemma Waters. Jemma?
Hello, hi everyone. Thanks for having me here today.
Oh, brilliant, I'm glad you're here. Jemma is the Head of Responsible Transformation at Lloyds Banking Group, where she works to help charities, SMEs, and job seekers to develop digital skills and use technology. She's also the co-author of the Consumer Digital Index and sits on the board of FutureDotNow. We've also got Adam Szabo. Adam?
Hi, Tiina. Yes, I'm here. Thanks for having me.
Brilliant. That's always great when everyone's here. Adam is the Chief Executive of Manchester Collective, an organisation that connects new audiences with what they refer to as an intimate and intense experiences built around classical music. Adam is responsible for the collective's audience, artistic and business strategy. So that's our amazing panel. So Liz, I'd like to come to you first and begin with a kind of a broad question. So over the last couple of Connected to Culture sessions, we've had questions about the digital divide and digital exclusion. And it kind of strikes me that as arts and cultural sector, if we're going to get the right skills to reach as many different people as possible, we need to first understand how people are getting online, if they are getting online at all. So Liz, could I invite you to give us an idea of exactly what we're talking about with the digital divide?
Yeah, thanks. That's a brilliant question. Great opening one. Today in the UK, there's about 17 million people that don't have what are defined by the government as the essential digital skills for life and work. And that people often think, well, what are those skills? Surely they're high-end skills, but we're not talking about robotics and coding. We're talking about really simple stuff like being able to go onto Google and undertake a search, being able to transact online, buy something. And then from a work perspective, you know, being able to go and access your payslip online or, you know, participate in an event like this using an online means. These are not high-end skills, they're absolutely the basics. And as I said, that's about half the UK working population, if you take it on average, that haven't got those skills. And I think that's quite shocking, actually, when you hear that number. But also maybe not that surprising when you hear that only 23% say that they've ever had any digital skills training from their employer. And I think that it's really interesting how we think about digital skills. We don't turn around to people and say, oh, because you've been, you know, brought up in the UK, you can automatically read, write in English. You know, we actually train people, we teach them. And I think we somehow, something happens a bit different with digital. We sort of expect people to pick those basic skills up by osmosis. So our role at FutureDotNow is absolutely shining a light on those essential digital skills with industry and really trying to encourage industry actually to do a lot more to help everybody get up to that baseline. And it would be great to have a conversation about what that means for the culture industry, because culture is both an employer, but it's also a massive motivator for people potentially to want to build their skills.
Thanks. That's such a low percentage when you're saying that only 23% have had training in digital skills. Wow. So practically speaking, what do you think, how should arts and cultural organisations consider this kind of significant proportion of the British public? You know, is it possible to reach these audiences, or in fact, do arts and cultural organisations have a role to play in helping the digital literacy of the country too?
So I'd absolutely say you do have a role, and actually you're a brilliant force for good in this area. We've done some work at FutureDotNow looking at how people build digital motives, because frankly, none of us want to build digital skills just for the sake of it. It's about what do those skills enable you to do. And what we've seen, if there's any positive out of COVID, and I'm not sure there are very many, but what we have seen is we've seen a massive acceleration in people's, you know, need to actually build their digital skills to be able to continue to do the things that they love. I mean, I don't think we should forget when saying that there are lots of people who have no connectivity. It's about 1.9 million households in the UK that don't have any connectivity at the moment. So I think there is two very distinct groups here. There's one group for whom there is a social issue, actually they're not online, and then there's others for whom, with the right motivations and the right, you know, instincts to be able to want to do it, they could do it. And that in particular, I think, is an area where the cultural sector is, you know, people want to come and enjoy the things, the brilliant range of things that the cultural sector offers. And digital now is a means, even if it's, you know, it might be about accessing collections online, but it also might be the way that you're buying your ticket to go into the situation if you can get there. So I do think you have a really important role to play in helping people want to build those skills and then helping them, showing them how to do it. So yeah, absolutely, big role.
Definitely. And Liz, you're also on the board of the London Transport Museum, that's been incredibly innovative with its use of new technology over the last 6 months, with its Hidden London tours. So I was just interested in how has the last 6 months influenced the digital skills that are needed in-house?
It's been, I mean, every organisation on this call, I'm sure, will know just how tough it has been. I don't think many of us ever expected to have to close our doors in the way that we have. For us at the Transport Museum, you know, we've got a strong digital presence, and we've really used this as an opportunity to really invest in that. I mean, if I can tell you a little bit about Hidden London tours. So we go and invite people to go to those stations that are shut. They're not, they don't exist on the network. They are closed places, Hidden London, the clues in the name. And they're really popular as a physical thing. But we've been able to take those virtual, and that's been really exciting. And what we found is, I mean, we've had a ridiculous number of people sign up for them. But the thing that I found really exciting was we had one recently, one of the virtual tours, and somebody declared that they dialed in from the US. They were joining us from the US, and Chris, who was running the tour, said, "Oh, maybe we should look at the timings that we're doing these, because clearly suddenly we've got new audiences that we wouldn't have expected in normal times." And so they had this conversation, at which point this gentleman joined up and said, "But I'm in Australia, so please don't do that." So I suppose what I'm saying is, you know, in some ways it's been a real opportunity for us. It's made us look slightly differently at the way that we deliver some things. We didn't really think you could virtually invite somebody to join you in a hidden London underground station, but actually we've proved that you can. We've also really invested in our online shopping and things like that, and that's been a massive injection of revenue. But we do a huge amount of work with schools, and that whole program is now being pivoted to digital. But I think the thing I would keep saying as you know, as we're having this conversation and everybody's talking about the brilliance of pivot of the digital provision, and I'm a massive fan, let's always remember though that at the moment there are a large proportion of people that can't access it. So how do we make sure that we continue to remember them, and we find ways to help them either come with us, or remember that we can't just deliver digitally. We have to find other ways to make sure that we're reaching the full gambit of people, really.
Thanks, Liz. No, definitely kind of inclusion both ways, digital and non-digital ways, is important. Thank you. And I'd like to move on to ask Gemma a couple of questions now. Gemma, are you there?
I am. Hello. Hi there.
So from the work that you've done with Lloyds, and particularly through working with lots of different types of organisations, whether they're large or small, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit more about what you're seeing in terms of types of skills organisations are really needing or valuing since the pandemic started.
Yeah, sure. So I suppose, being the kind of organisation that we are, we work with companies, organisations of all different shapes and sizes. But actually, I've been quite surprised, I suppose, really, at how similar the transition has been for us inside a large organisation, as well as with some of the small businesses that we work with day in, day out, and then also some of the charities that we partner with and work with on a more kind of strategic basis as well. So I think, to start with, you know, like many of us, I think it was about how do we just immediately react to this situation? How can we use digital to communicate, connect, inform ourselves, find out information? And we found a lot of the work that we were doing kind of in communities previously had been face to face. So for us, the immediate response was, okay, how do we pivot to connecting into these organizations locally and address some of those challenges? So is that about helping with remote working hints and tips? Is it about the software, the hardware that they need in order to do that? And, you know, across the country at the time, there was such a challenge, and there still is, frankly, as Liz has mentioned before, with devices, with provision, with the ability just frankly to access the internet. And I think that's where, you know, the kind of crux of our response started, and also some of the challenges that we saw initially. But I think what we've started to see through some of our research, as well as the work that we do with communities, is obviously, you know, kind of more towards the start of the summer, people realised actually we're in this for the long haul, and all of us, you know, have had to really think about how we pivot what we do and how we do it, really think about business models. So, you know, we know from research that we're publishing later in the month, later in November, that a lot of small businesses, you know, had to pause, had to close their doors. But actually, there's been this, you know, fantastic entrepreneurship of thinking through e-commerce solutions, thinking about digital marketing, how to find consumers online. All of that requires, you know, a leap into the unknown for a lot of organizations from a technical perspective. You know, where do you start with hardware, software, etc.? But most importantly, and I think what's been really exciting, is how, you know, a lot of the organizations that we've been speaking to and working with definitely are having really challenging times, but actually it's the kind of problem solving, the kind of creativity, thinking through new approaches, taking a step back and thinking about what they want their organization to do and be going forward. Actually, that's kind of been a lot of the skills and the conversations that we've been having across the breadth of the summer. And I think, as Liz said before, you know, something that we're trying to work with charities and small businesses, you know, particularly around at the moment, is also the fact that, you know, a lot of things are moving online. A lot of things, you know, digital skills are no doubt important, but actually, if there are 9 million people in the UK who can't access the internet or turn on a device by themselves, actually, how can we, as a large organisation that's across the breadth of the UK, make a difference in helping people to get online for the first time? But also, how can we help small businesses, and how can we help our larger corporate clients to be as inclusive as possible and make sure they're considering things like accessibility, inclusivity, and also those digital barriers as they're developing new kind of tools and products and services, you know, as these things change. So, but I mean, at the moment, frankly, I think everyone's still in that mode of actually, how do we, you know, how do we just respond? How do we just deal with the day to day? And I think by and large, that's why really what we're seeing now is a real focus on those kind of productivity levers. What are the things that can take out some of the stress in the back office that I, as a business owner or as an organizational leader, can just get on with the things that I need to do and that I want to do to kind of keep my business surviving and thriving at this time? So yeah, a lot of kind of online accountancy platform considerations and as I say, some of those kind of tools and tips to kind of help manage more back office activities as well.
Thanks, Jemma. Interesting that you talk about kind of new approaches, how a lot of organisations that you worked with are taking stock in terms of where what they want to do and where they're at the moment. And in terms of any observations in terms of that change in organisations, whether you found that leaders of organisations have been willing or whether they've been resistant to change, and also if change is happening, how are organisations thinking about how do they make that change stick? So, you know, when or if we return to some kind of normality.
Good question.
Quite a lot there, but
So I think, I mean, firstly, and I think definitely, if I think about some of the small businesses we've been working with recently, so kind of around the 10 to 20 employee mark, as well as thinking about our own, you know, an organisation of 60,000 employees, it's massive. I think across, you know, all different areas, I think we've all realised now that normal has kind of passed us by, actually, frankly. And I think for me, just thinking about your question about leadership and resistance to change, I think that's one of the most interesting things that have kind of come out of this, I suppose, thinking about organisations of both those sizes. You know, the typical kind of hierarchy or construct is, you know, the people leading the business at the top are typically the people who have the most experience or have the most kind of understanding of what's going on, and kind of, you know, steer the ship in the right direction, so to speak. But I think what this, you know, what this pandemic has meant is no one knows, you know, frankly, you know, leaders have had to recognize that actually they don't have more information than other people in the organization. And I think what we've seen, you know, across a lot of the organizations that we work with is that it's kind of created a much flatter kind of set of organizations with a real kind of I guess leaders have had to become more vulnerable. They've had to share what they're worried about. They've had to look for help. You know, they've had to think about what does it mean to be a leader remotely? How do you inspire a team of 10, 11, 12 people, 20 people, 100 people, you know, through a screen? That's so tough. You can't rely on some of the kind of in-person, face-to-face workshops, breakout sessions, or kind of, you know, time spent together as a team that you normally would. So I think leaders have kind of, you know, I think we've probably seen over the last few months that they've had to go through this real reevaluation of what does that mean and what does that look like. And I think we've definitely, you know, we, as well as producing the consumer index and share open sourcing some of our data to help people understand the digital capability of different industries, we also, you know, part of the reason why we work with so many small businesses and with so many partner organizations is because we do a lot of activities. You know, we run the Lloyds Bank Academy and we work with Job Centre Plus and lots of different organizations. And I guess, you know, what we're now seeing is that, you know, our leadership training, our management training, some of those things that we're providing and open sourcing, that's where we're getting the most amount of kind of interest and activity, because leaders are kind of saying, right, you know, I've had to go through this completely unique, bizarre experience and just kind of keep everyone happy, well, you know, the well-being point, I don't think can be underestimated, how much leaders have had to reflect on what that means for themselves, as well as looking after the organisation. And I think now that's kind of where we're at, really, is understanding that some of the greatest needs out there are actually supporting people kind of mentally with, you know, problem solving, resilience, support, and some of those aspects, really.
It also strikes me that this is a time when organisations need to learn from one another. So,
definitely.
Yeah. Any thoughts in terms of good kind of facilitating that knowledge sharing from you?
Yeah, so I think a lot of the things that I've personally been involved in, or you know, our team have been involved in more generally, has been more kind of regional, local networking and connections. I think they're so valuable. Whether that's, you know, some of the sessions that we've kind of been part of and running in kind of Bristol, London, in the Northwest, we've got some activities coming up in Leeds. But I think just connecting with local businesses and understanding how they're faring, what are some of the ways in which you can kind of help each other and work together on things, is just so invaluable. If I think about where I live in Northeast London, you know, our high street, the small businesses have come together, you know, they've kind of shared investment in new technologies and shared understanding, and it's been great being part of that. And as a customer, as someone who really cares about the community as well, knowing that you know, you can kind of participate and help shape in that way is so important. So I think for me, that kind of regional hyper local support is just really key, and also just kind of transparency and vulnerability. I think a lot of the leaders that we've been working with, you know, as I say, they've been running their small business for 20, 30 years. They're used to being the expert, and actually asking for help is really new. And, you know, I think it's up to us as organisations working with those companies to be empathetic and open and, you know, also recognise and share. No one has any of the answers at this time. All we can do is learn from each other. So, yeah, I think that's probably one of the takeaways I'd have.
Yeah, learn from one another. I'd agree with that. Thank you, Jemma. Okay, I'd like to move on to hear a little bit from Adam. Adam, are you still there?
Yes, I'm present.
Great, thank you. So over the last 6 months, it's been very difficult to ignore some of the amazing content that you've been putting out there and its success. What's been your approach to the types of skills required in-house, and how would you recommend others go about it?
Great. Okay. Thanks, Tiina. Big question. So I run an arts organisation. For anyone that isn't familiar with our work, pre-COVID, we were a touring group of musicians, and we would often be collaborating with artists from quite different kind of musical worlds or different art forms even. I guess if anyone is going to thrive in the arts in this sort of, you know, digital economy and post-COVID world, then I think one of the things that has been really important for us is that the way that we traditionally plan work and plan seasons ahead has been brought much closer together with our kind of communications and marketing team. And I guess maybe there are organizations that sort of pre-COVID we're thinking about content as like, you know, almost as like ad copy or sort of fly posting or something that you kind of send out there to raise awareness. And I think if we're working in a completely digital space, and actually we find ourselves in a world where, you know, there are very many cases where the content is actually the art and the art is the content. And it means that at a much higher level in organizations and at a much earlier level in the artistic planning process, I think we have to be really aware of what it is that we're actually making and how it is that we're going to distribute the thing that we're making. The way that this has manifested itself in our organization is that for years now, we've had a filmmaker on retainer who has worked with us throughout the whole process of creating touring work before we were ever really doing live streams. And I think it's just, you know, it's absolutely essential that they're kind of part of the whole sausage making process, I guess, because without having that content before you know what you're going to do with it, it's very, very difficult to kind of connect with audiences in a way that is authentic and not like you've just cut together sort of 30 seconds of sort of teaser material. I mean, we have had a couple of kind of big hits, I guess, over the last few months, and most recently, this sort of bananas piece of video, which kind of did some laps around the world, really, and ended up picking up kind of millions of engagements. And I think, although that's a very kind of exciting story, I think the other thing that we really need to be paying attention to is the metrics that we're really using when we're measuring the success of the content and the work that we're producing. I guess, you know, in the arts, we're not really in the kind of popularity or the reach game. You know, that's not why we do what we do. If you're a mission-driven organization and there's an aspiration to create something which is more than something which is kind of fun to consume, then I think we have to really interrogate the metrics that we're following, and actually it's depth of engagement as well as just kind of reach or kind of popularity that we really have to be looking at. Certainly it feels like, you know, very rapidly, as I think Gemma mentioned, the whole sector is going through this sort of insane evolution where at the beginning it was like, okay, great, you know, let's like put a camera in front of an exhibition or a group of musicians or a dance company and fantastic, we can get that out online. And then it was like, okay, great, how can we get that video in front of as many people as possible? And now I think we're really starting to think about, okay, what does the nature of that engagement actually look like? Is it something which is comparable to being in, you know, at some kind of an arts event in a live context? Is it actually a completely other thing? If it's a different thing, what does that look like? Is it something that we actually have to plan in a really bespoke way in an entirely different part of our work than the way that we plan our live work? I mean, I'm sure that everyone on this panel has been feeling, I mean, maybe not, maybe it's just me, but certainly I have been feeling a huge amount of like video fatigue and Zoom fatigue, and after spending a day on your screens, often the last thing you want to do is chuck on like King Lear or something and get some digital Shakespeare in your life, you know, and that stuff is great. But, you know, I think we have to recognize that the digital content that is going to kind of rise to the top in what is at the moment a really saturated online marketplace is going to need to be bespoke, and it's going to have to either be like absolutely outstanding quality, or it's going to have to be substantially different enough that there's a reason for people to engage. So yeah, sorry, that was a very waffly response, but they're my thoughts.
No, I agree. I think that, you know, bespoke and high quality is just so important as always, but particularly at the moment when it's all digital. And measuring success, and we could spend a whole session talking about measuring success.
I would say, sorry, Tiina, that on the measuring success thing, this is something that we all have to be part of this discussion. And I know, you know, we're really fortunate to be funded by the Arts Council. You know, in like a big part of our turnover comes from support from the Arts Council. But the reporting aspect of what we do when it comes to digital is like a deeply unsatisfactory system as it currently stands. No one has really figured out how we can measure the efficacy of the work that we're making yet. And so, I mean, certainly it's something that we're spending a lot of time thinking about at the moment, about what are we actually trying to achieve with this work? Because someone like clicking on a Facebook video is like not enough.
No, that's very true. And I was also interested in having those skills in organizations to be able to kind of measure that success of the digital content, for example. And I was just curious on your views on, does it matter from, you know, where do those skills come from? Is it about upskilling existing staff? Is it skills that we already have? Or is it skills that come from outside the sector?
I think it's highly unlikely that they're skills that we already have. I guess we've always been really interested in bringing in skills and staff and artists from other sort of musical worlds and artistic worlds, and indeed completely other sectors. And it feels like, you know, particularly in what I guess I might call like the heritage arts world, because it's been such a live focused party for so many years, there's not really been the kind of commercial motivation for us to really sort of figure this stuff out until now. And of course now suddenly it's very, very important that we kind of get our houses in order. I mean, for me actually, it's been really interesting to look at case studies from different sectors. I mean, actually the media and newspapers is a really interesting area where they were dealing with their own kind of COVID disaster, you know, years ago when people stopped buying papers, and looking at how different outlets and different kind of presenters have adapted to this, like, drastically changing economy is very interesting. And, you know, from the kind of, you know, Guardian's like, no paywall, but please donate, and we're going to remind you in this way, to other papers that have, you know, paywalls to access like different parts of content or the whole paper or supplementary packages that you put together. I mean, these are all of the models that we see are being piloted now in the arts world. And it's very easy to forget that a lot of this has been done already, and there are big lessons that we can learn by speaking with, you know, whether or not it's like the Lloyds guys or the newspapers or whatever, by looking at case studies from kind of other sectors. So, no, certainly I think that's also, like, you know, the arts is such an echo chamber. Like, we're in real danger of just like talking to a sort of party of like earnest fans who all think the same thing. And so, you know, if we're not engaging with people from other parts of the sort of, you know, kind of population, then I feel like we've kind of lost the battle already, really.
No, indeed, Adam. Actually, linked to that, I'd like to take one of the questions from that were pre-submitted to us. And it was a question from Beverly Day from Lakeland Arts and Victoria Morford from Chatham Historic Dockyard Trust, who said, what are the most important digital skills to focus on in the current climate and to ensure a sustainable future for digital content creation and engagement? And wondering if you had, Adam, anything to pick around that, particularly content creation is kind of where that you're passionate about.
Yeah, I suppose the two models that we see with content is either organizations upskill internally and try and, you know, bring in the equipment and develop the skills that they need to create content, to distribute that content, or they kind of outsource. And I think both can really work. Actually, it's the second bit of the question that I find extremely concerning, which is about the sustainable whatever. I mean, nothing about what we're doing at the moment is sustainable, because we're giving away huge amounts of our work for free. The bits that we're not giving away for free, we're often showing to an extremely small audience. And I feel like, you know, this is something that it has evolved at a huge pace, you know, this year, and obviously will keep changing. I mean, I think for us, you know, going back to the how we measure success, the engagement thing is really important. And in our work, certainly, there are a very small number of very highly engaged audience members who do a huge amount of the heavy lifting when it comes to kind of evangelization and selling records and bringing in new fans. And so, in a way, I guess I would encourage a specific rather than a broad strategy when it comes to distribution. And of course, you know, we all have the resources now to go kind of full Cambridge Analytica on our digital audiences, so we can do that. I think that a general message is the message that is going to get lost in a saturated market. In terms of the actual content creation, I mean, I'm repeating myself, but I think having that in mind at the beginning of the artistic process is really, really vital. And I think we have to recognize that if we're going to have different sort of content or like product outcomes at the end of this development process, then we're going to have to work in different ways. And so it's not enough to go, okay, well, we've got some budget for a camera crew that we're going to put in front of our orchestra, and then they can just do their rehearsals and do their show as per normal. This is going to cost more money, or it's going to mean that we have to restructure the way that we plan and we deliver these projects. And there's definitely areas where I think, you know, there's work that can cross over and something works in the real world and also works as a digital product. But often I think actually the truth is that something will really fly in a digital space and be sort of like, you know, a bit meh in the real world, or vice versa. And we have to be brave enough to recognize that not everything has to do everything for everyone.
Indeed. And I think that restructuring the way we plan, that kind of links me to the next question from the audience, which was around, this one is from Carmen Talbot from the Heritage Museum, which was about interested in hearing from the experts about how their organisations have adjusted or created strategies to support their staff and volunteers to use digital tools during the pandemic. And I was wondering if maybe Liz or Emma, Gemma, if you've got anything particularly that you'd like to add to that, please?
I mean, I don't mind kicking off. I mean, I'd just like to pick up actually on something that Adam, when Adam was talking, that went through my mind. I think part of the problem that we have is that digital is so all-encompassing. We live in a world now that it's a digital society, right? And so digital skills can mean, you know, the person that's able to package a different way of experiencing an arts experience, that to how you sell a ticket and how somebody actually gets in through your front door, to actually somebody even going on Google to actually find out about your organization in the first place. So there are so many skills that come under this kind of definition of digital skills. And Gemma's done some brilliant work from the team at Lloyds looking about how you categorize the different types of digital skills. And, you know, and I've been working with some of that, you know, you've got these basic skills and then you've got the general skills that everybody needs. And then you've got these advanced skills. And I think we need to really just think about that and not just see it as one thing. But in terms of the question about how organizations have adjusted and created strategies, I mean, you know, we've been working with a couple of organizations at FutureDotNow in a kind of trailblazer capacity. And one of those has been Nationwide, the Building Society, who've already done, you know, a lot in the same way that Lloyds have done in terms of helping people move banking online. But I think it's a really interesting example, because what they saw, despite having a big push to try and help people, go and enjoy digital banking, suddenly when people couldn't go to the branch, suddenly saw a very different level of energy around it. And what they did was they've done a lot of work working with us, looking at how do they make sure that their branch staff are confident in their own abilities to then be able to pass that on. And I think that's something I'd really encourage everybody to think about, is what is the starting point within your organization anyway? And does everybody have the basics? And then how do you help them grow through? And how do we recognize just how pivotal this is? Because the role of champions, those who've been through the journey, is really important. And Gemma was talking about senior leaders, and I think the other thing we've discovered through this process is not all of the senior leaders have perhaps got the digital skills that they might need going forward, because suddenly, you know, the person that perhaps has been doing some of this stuff for them at the back door, you know, it was not there at their desk when they were suddenly locked in, as we all were. Gemma, I'm sure you've got some other examples you'd like to share.
Yeah, I think it goes back to what you were saying, really, Liz. It's about helping people understand that this is just a different way of getting to the outcome that they want to get to. So actually, to the point around, you know, helping inspire people and really feel things through art, actually digital can be a different channel or distribution route to get there. But actually, if we focus on the outcome, which is we want to help people experience this art, you'd be surprised, I think, at how, you know, investigating the different channels and the different opportunities there are available can make such a big difference. I think there's also a little bit, dare I say it, there's a little bit of emperor's new clothes sometimes with some of this stuff. A lot of it is jargon, and actually a lot of it is quite sensible stuff. It's just got a different name because it's on a computer. So I think, yeah, it's about helping people within your own organisations understand and feel more confident with what it is that they're doing, and realizing that some of the things, you know, if I think about website design, it's basically how can we help the small businesses that we work with? You know, it's their shop front. How can we make it warm, inviting? How can we understand the customers that come in and really understand them and what it is they want to buy? That's all online analytics is. It's understanding people, it's understanding their behaviours, and it's putting things, you know, in the right places for them, just like you would do in a kind of physical presence. So, yeah, I think there's something about demystifying language that's really important, as well as also helping everyone in the organisation feel confident that no one knows everything, but what they do know is hugely valuable, hugely important. And actually, digital is something that you know, people can learn, people can pick up as they go. So I think that would be my kind of two pennies worth.
I think that, can I just continue down? I think that's really true, Gemma, because I remember somebody saying this to me a few months ago, everybody thinks that everybody else is better at digital than they are. And then what that happens is nobody is prepared to really admit their own fragility. And I think that COVID enabled us to do that. I mean, I've worked in the digital skills area for like over a decade. You know, I have palpitations the moment somebody says to me, can you go on a different platform? You know, like this is on Google and I use Zoom a lot of the time, and suddenly you go, oh God, it's slightly different. But that's not you know, that's the platform issue. It's not about my skills. It's just familiarity and getting people to realize that, you know, we don't all have everything, but you can learn and you can grow. And we've all got the potential to grow. So I think Gemma's point about demystifying is so important.
I'd agree with that, Liz. I think it is partly about confidence and that demystifying of it. And, you know, we all need to boost our digital skills, whatever level we are. And that's just kind of an ongoing learning and ongoing process as technology keeps changing, sometimes faster than we can keep up with. So it's just that confidence of keeping learning. I think we've got just about time for one more question. I've got, there's a question around how do you best get buy-in and engagement with digital skills across the organisation while also keeping the value of specialism level of digital and marketing staff? This one was from Holly from Heritage Doncaster. For example, she gave an example that sometimes, even in an organisation, everyone starts wanting to post on social media, for example, they might not be aware of the planning and strategy behind social. So it's about how do you retain that specialism whilst getting buy-in. Adam, is there anything you'd like to contribute to that?
I would be very worried if everyone in my organization wanted to start posting on social media. I mean, I think in a way it is valuing the specialism of these skills, and in the same way that I just honestly don't really see the distinction between, like, you wouldn't just get every member of staff, you know, to give a pre-concept talk either. Like, this is something that is a really very specific mode of communication with our public audiences. And so I think we need to have a really, really careful approach. I mean, I do think that, you know, the arts in many ways, like, this is sort of a... you know, of course it's really important that we, like, all upskill and do our best and all of this stuff, but in many ways the arts are facing kind of an existential threat at the moment with this stuff. And so I do think that it's not going to be enough for everyone to, like, slowly get a bit better. Like, we have to bring in these skills if we don't have them, and I don't think we can kind of mess about for too long, because, you know, there's sort of a limited number of stimulus packages that our sector is going to get. And if we can't be meeting people out in the real world, then we just have to develop effective ways of communicating with them digitally.
And thank you, Adam. So lots there to think about. I think some of the key takeaways from me for this session has been the conversation around digital exclusion in terms of lack of digital skills and access to broadband, how it's, you know, affecting some of the most deprived people in our communities, and how arts and culture sector needs to be mindful in its engagement and digital activity, and how we can also be a bit of a force for good in terms of digital skills development more broadly. I also picked out the bit about the range of digital skills that are needed are incredibly vast. I think Liz picked up on that. And how we also, as Adam's mentioned, you know, it's something that we need to do now and swiftly, not in the kind of the distant future. I think those digital skills also need to be really valued in organisations. And I think that fostering that sense of digital curiosity and buy-in across the whole organisation is just as crucial as practical skills on, I don't know, how to read data analytics or how to run a social media account. And I think Gemma's point around sometimes it's necessary not to use the word digital when it comes to convincing someone to unwilling to make the change. So whether it's that word that sometimes kind of carries a little bit of baggage. So it's about how we can achieve what's really important. And I think there was something that Adam mentioned about restructuring the way we plan, and bringing in that kind of digital thinking earlier in artistic planning and decision making, and also a whole conversation around measuring success, which I think is something that I'd probably like to kind of cover in future sessions. So lots of different themes and topics, which we could totally delve into for another few hours. So hopefully that's kind of brought some broad insights, and hopefully there's some bits of actionable ones too. I'm conscious of time, and I'd like to invite Moira from Google Arts and Culture to talk a little bit about their Connected to Culture playbook, which picks out on some of these themes and has some kind of practical tips on how to take some of these things forward. So Moira, could I pass on to you, please?
Yes, thank you, Tiina. And hi, everyone. Thank you so much today. It's really interesting to hear from Liz, Adam and Jemma, just on all the insights that you have from your experience. If you want to learn a little bit more about how to build your digital skills for the future, then you can find a toolkit that Google Arts and Culture have created called Connected to Culture, which is linked here. And I know, Liz, you mentioned digital skills can mean so much, and that's absolutely correct. And in this toolkit, you can really find a range of things to support you with how to deliver your cultural programs online, how to reach audiences, make the most of digital tools in a creative way, but also to meet the needs of your organization at this time, which is a kind of new experience for so many people. So please do have a look at it and let me know if you have any questions. Feel free to reach out, and I hope you find it helpful.
Thank you, Moira. And on that, we're nearly out of time for our session. So let me just say, absolutely huge thank you to our panel. It's been fantastic discussion with plenty of fascinating and important insights. I hope you all enjoyed the conversation as much as I have, and it's certainly given some food for thought around digital skills development. So a big thank you for everyone who's joined us and for your questions. And we hope to see you all again at our next Connected to Culture webinar, which is around business models on 19th of November. So thank you everyone for joining.